Well, this is now the second week of our series, Practices of Jesus Followers. Last week, Kelly spoke on two of those practices. Two of the more obvious ones, the Lord's Supper, where we remember that Christ gave his life for us. Yes, Christ is the great shepherd who lays down his life for us. So monthly in our tradition, we remember what he did for us on the cross. And of course, baptism, where we come out and say, yes, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. But you know, in reality, there are many, many practices that Christians practice. And I like to talk about two of them. But before I do, let me just list some of them. Corporate worship is an example of a Christian practice. It was designed to have an impact on us as we all come together and use our gifts throughout the week and as we gather on Sunday. The reading of Scripture, you know, Scripture is kind of like soul food. Something that we need to read on a regular basis. And that's how God speaks to us in the clearest way today. Also, memorizing Scripture. And I guess that's why I so love Awana program, because kids come to that program and just memorize Scripture. And you know, it stays with them. And I'm going to do a little exercise a little bit later and give you evidence of the fact that you have memorized Scripture along the way and it's in your heart today. And then giving. Giving is part of what it means to be a Christian. And you know, one of the great things of giving, not to mention the fact that it supports all sorts of great causes around the world, is it frees us from materialism. The giving is the great antidote to just holding on too tightly to money. And of course, there's retreats and seminars. All these things can have a real impact on you. You know, I can still remember going to a retreat 40 years ago when I was in college. I guess it'd be a little more than that, wouldn't it? But anyways, it was a retreat. And the speaker was Bob Anderson, and he was speaking from the book of Philippians. I can still remember being there. That's a long time ago. And he just gave me a hunger for God's word. And then there's small groups, which I call great places of prayer and learning and fellowship. And I'm going to read a testimony to you that came to me this week from someone who had a really amazing encounter with God in their small group. And of course, then there's prayer, communion with God. Responding to the leading of the Spirit. Sometimes you just sense in life that the Spirit is prompting you to do something, and when you follow, wow, all those really exciting things happen. Think of missions trips. Friends, I think the DNA of our church was very much affected by the fact that when Dave Moore came here, he got us going to Mexico. 200 of you have made that journey. There's 87 houses down there, but I think more importantly, our hearts were changed. We look at our world a little differently because we engaged in that Christian practice of serving and caring for the less fortunate. Now think of listening to Christian music. I don't listen to a lot, but there's people here this morning who listen to it all the time, and it just really nourishes their heart. I think of witnessing. Oh, I skipped fasting, didn't I? Most of us do. But you know what? When we read the Scripture, there are people who fast, take a time out from food so they can pray. It's one of those practices, friends. Maybe we should encourage one another. Witnessing. Well, when you're out there sharing your faith comes alive. It seems like you're more in touch with God when you're sharing the good news. And then there's journaling, writing out what God is doing in your heart. And then the reading of Christian books, and I know many of you do that. And there's usually a stack on my desk. Oh, Pastor, you've got to read this. So I take it, and the stack grows. I just don't read fast enough. But anyways, there's so many different ways, friends. So many practices, so many things we can do, so many good habits that, in fact, nourish our hearts and help us stay true to Jesus. So this morning, I'm going to continue on and talk about two more practices. One is the reading of Scripture. And the other one is prayer. But I'm going to combine them here this morning to talk about something I call praying Scripture. Praying Scripture. Now, as part of our introduction to ministry internship, we actually have our interns practice this. We ask them that before you come to work, before you come to ministry time, we want you to read Scripture, feed your own soul. And then we want you to pray. Write a prayer out based on what you have read. For example, on day 41, Scott Turner wrote, In fact, first of all, Scott read Isaiah chapter 26, 1-3. It's a passage that contains this fairly well-known verse. You will keep in perfect peace those whose minds are steadfast because they trust in you. And so in response, Scott wrote this prayer. I pray I would turn to you, Lord, and know your perfect peace. I pray that my eyes would stay fixed on you. On day 42, Scott read all of Isaiah chapter 6. And in response, he wrote this prayer. I pray my heart's desire would be to glorify your name. I pray that I would acknowledge that all I have is from you. I also pray that I'll remember that I have done nothing for my salvation. Scott clearly understands that he's on a grace-based relationship with God. On day 45, Scott read Isaiah 35, a chapter that speaks of God's saving power and the joy and blessings of being one of God's children. And so we prayed this prayer. Dear Father, thank you for desiring your relationship with us. Help us to follow you with all our heart and to never lose focus. And I love the way he closed this prayer. Give me love for you. Well, Scott's prayers, friends, were very much a response to what he was reading in the Bible. Last year, 2016, Ben Froese also served an internship with us. And on May 9th, Ben read Matthew chapter 23, verses 1-12. Where Jesus warns the Pharisees and warns us of doing good deeds just to be seen by men. It's also a passage that goes on to talk about greatness in God's kingdom. It's really servanthood. It's not about power, it's about servanthood. So Ben prayed this simple prayer. Father, help me to live a life of service to others, patterning my life after Jesus' life. On June 7th, 2016, Ben read 2 Corinthians chapter 5 that reminds us that God has given us this ministry of reconciliation, a passage where the Apostle Paul says that he's really compelled by the love of Christ. Amen. So in response, Ben simply wrote this prayer. God, may your love and goodness compel me to be an agent of reconciliation, sharing the good news of the gospel. And then on July 9th, Ben read James chapter 4, verses 1-12. A passage that contains some rather well-known verses, and I'm going to prove that right now. Let me read three verses, and I'm going to have you complete the verse for me. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the who? Humble. Right. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. See, you guys know these verses. And isn't that a great promise? Because all of us drift away from God at times. I mean, you may even start a day being really close to God, and then busyness takes over, and before you know it, boy, you're not even thinking about him anymore. But with a promise, come near to God, and he will come near to you. Here's another one. Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will lift you up. There you go. See, some of you people have memorized these key verses from the book of James. So in response to this passage, yes, these well-known verses, Ben simply prayed. Father, I come to you today. I humbly acknowledge my need for you and my need to depend on you. Be my loving leader. Be my loving leader. Friends, to say the very least, I was really encouraged to read the prayers of these two young men. They had 85 entries each in their journal. God is being honored by these young men, and you know what? By many young men and young women in the life of our community. And I hope it was really clear that these prayers that Ben were praying, that Scott were praying, were deeply rooted in Scripture. In essence, their prayers were responses to what God was teaching them. Again, I call this praying Scripture. A practice that I think really encourages us to respond, to really simply respond back to God based on what he has just said to us when we read our Bible. A practice that really encourages us to have a conversation with God. A practice that helps us to pray about things that really, really matter to God. And yes, I think a practice that will transform your life if you begin to pray the values of Scripture into your own heart and life. But I also want to say this. I think this is a practice that can be turned into a wonderful ministry. And we call this ministry the Ministry of Intercessory Prayer. Let me illustrate. On May 3rd, I read John chapter 5. And it's a big chapter. And as I read it, verse 23 jumped out to me. And it reads this: that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Well, this verse says something about the person of Christ, doesn't it? He is to be honored just as our Father in heaven is. And of course, the context tells us why. It's because just as the Father can give life, so can the Son. And furthermore, the Father has given the Son the right of being the judge. Therefore, we are to honor Jesus just as we honor our Heavenly Father. And so on May 3rd, I found myself praying through pages 40 to 41 in our church directory. Page 40 begins with Pretty Ready and ends on 41 with Maddie Sales and lots of people in between. And so I simply pray that all these people would make it their goal that day to honor Jesus. And of course, I'm praying for myself as well. Now, can you really pray better than a prayer like, "Oh Lord, help us to honor you this day"? On May 4th, I found myself in Psalm 56. And as I read this psalm over a couple times, verses 4 and 11 jumped out to me. They're very, very similar ideas. In God I trust, I'm not afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? In God I trust that I'm not afraid. What can man do to me? Now the context of this verse is King David. And if you know anything about King David, he was often a man on the run. He had his enemies. He was a politician. He was a king in a world that was often in conflict. He even had family members seeking his life at times. But David resolved in this psalm that he wasn't going to let fear run his life. Rather, he was going to trust in God. And so that day, I found myself on pages 24 and 25 of our church directory. I started thinking about all these people, all the way from Claire Irvine right down to Peter and Danielle Kolponsky. And I thought about this and I prayed, "Father, I don't think any of these people have enemies like King David did. And I sure hope they don't. But you know what? They do have an enemy, don't they? The enemy of their souls, as we read about in the book of James. The book of Peter, where Satan is described as a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. So in fact, we all have our enemies, really. But you know, in human terms, I thought about this, and I said, "Father, I don't know if any of them do, in fact, have enemies other than the enemy himself. But Father, I know that these people all have issues in their life where they need to trust you." I think that'd be true of everyone here this morning. There's issues before you where you need to trust God. And so that day, I just prayed. "Father, I pray for Claire and Blanche and Paul and Christy and Bernie and Janine and Kevin and Karen and Alessia and Willow and Jonathan and Bethany and Andrew and Jessica and Jacobus and Antoinette and George and Marjorie and Peter and Daniel, that they would trust you regardless of the issue that is before them this day, in Christ's name."
Amen.
And as I prayed that, I realized I have issues that I need to trust God for, right here and now as I speak this morning. Well, on May 5th, my Bible reading included a few verses from the book of Proverbs, and I enjoy Proverbs so much. And here's a couple verses. "Those who plan what is good find love and faithfulness." Those who plan what is good? Not those who wait and sit around and wait for it to come to them, but they take the initiative to do good in their world. "Then the fear of the Lord is the fountain of life, turning a person from the snares of death." And then this great proverb: "Whoever is kind to the needy honors God." Now these verses obviously speak about our inner motivations and our attitude and disposition towards God, and as well as our relationship to the less fortunate. Proverbs says wise people live this way. So on that day, I found myself on pages 10 and 11 of our church directory that starts with the Columbus family right down to Susan Bacon. And I simply prayed, "Heavenly Father, thank you for all those people who make Summit Drive their home. Thank you for their presence in our midst. And I pray, Father, that these people would have awesome respect for you. And that their awesome respect for you would encourage them to run from sin. And Father, I pray that these people would be planning and initiating good in their community and homes. And give each of them, Father, an open hand to the needy. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Again, I was simply responding to the Word of God and praying those values into the life of others and yes, myself. So let me summarize what I've been saying here this morning. Firstly, praying Scripture is a way of bringing solid content to your prayer life. Like, I think it's perfectly fine to say, oh, Father, I just pray today that you bless Carl and Lori Jane. That's a fine way to pray. Father, I just pray you bless Jeremy and Louie. But I think it's more profound, after you've read the Word of God, is to pray what God is saying to you into the lives of your brothers and sisters in Christ. Secondly, praying Scripture, I think, is a way of responding to what God has said to you through the reading of Scripture. In essence, all of Ben's prayers and all of Scott's prayers resulted from them listening to God and then simply responding back to God based on what he has said to them. And may I throw to you that, is it not a bit rude if God has taken the time to speak to you and we do not respond back? And let me just illustrate this for a moment. Is Colton around here? Colton. I'm going to give you this mic here. And Colton, I want you to tell me about your trip from Oklahoma to Kansas this past December. Would you tell me about that trip?
Yeah, I'll tell you about that trip, Harry. So first we set out from Oklahoma, and we started driving. We drove through, west kind of Oklahoma, on our way through Texas, and finally we landed in Albuquerque.
Colton, I hope you phone your mom today. It is Mother's Day.
So we stayed the night in Albuquerque, New Mexico, Harry. And we got up in the morning, drove through this beautiful desert, all kinds of cool, kind of looks a little bit like Kamloops. We kept driving, we made our way through Flagstaff, Arizona.
All right, thank you. Have a seat. I was completely rude. I wasn't listening to him. I changed the topic. I wasn't paying attention. I wasn't giving him any feedback on what he was saying. And you know, I think it's possible to do that to God sometimes. We just read a passage of Scripture where he's screaming to us how much he loves us. And we don't even respond back. We just kind of get on with our day. Friends, there is a living, loving, awesome person behind the Word of God who is seeking to communicate to us. Thank you, Debbie. Well, thirdly, praying Scripture, I believe, is a way of aligning your heart and life after God's will. To read Scripture and then to pray those values into your life or the lives of others is really, I believe, a transforming exercise, a transforming practice. It's really about cooperating with God. Because as we read the Scriptures, it's really clear that once he's called you to himself, he's going to continue to work in your life. And he promises to perfect you one day. So in fact, when we enter into prayer and praying his values and Christ-like virtues into our life, we are cooperating with what God is doing. And then fourthly, praying Scripture is a way of interceding for others. People really appreciate it when you say to them, hey, I'm praying for you. People really do appreciate it. I want you to consider now an email that I received this week from a lady I highly respect who was a little reluctant to share her story, but she said yes. I'm going to read it to you. My story. Being part of a small, comfortable, and trusting Bible study group is so important. I had an experience that was so empowering. I have a chronic health issue, and the symptoms are at times overwhelming. It was in the middle of a Bible study that the words were said regarding the Apostle Paul, that he had a lot of anguish and boy, probably inner screaming in the midst of his heart. I somehow blurted out, "That was me." I was screaming on the inside as I wanted to be home in bed, and here I was in a Bible study feeling sick. I started to cry. Suddenly I was surrounded by 10 to 12 ladies holding my hand and praying out loud, "God, help me." Calling out for God to help me. It took some time for me to settle down as the tears flowed. What I remember is that the planned Bible study did not continue, but rather a general discussion on what had just occurred and the importance of prayer. And then, each week for the last 4 weeks, I told the group that I was feeling well and I had no symptoms. And I thanked everyone for their prayer. I happened to share this story with Pastor Harry, and he asked me to write it out, what had happened to me. What a blessing God, prayer, and Bible study has been in my life. Stories like this are always so encouraging to me. I don't want to stand before God one day and say, "You didn't have because you didn't ask, Harry." Let's ask. We have things on our hearts. Let's ask. And finally, friends, praying the Bible, praying Scripture, is one of the keys to answered prayer. Please note this verse, 1 John 5:14. "This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us." And may I add here, when you are praying Scripture, you are praying according to His will. One Bible scholar said this, "When we learn to want what God wants, we have the joy of receiving His answers to our petitions." So I conclude, praying Scripture is an invaluable practice for believers. In closing this morning, I want to invite you to join me in a very short exercise. An exercise in praying Scripture, both for ourselves and also for those seated next to you here this morning. The passage I'd like to pray into our lives here this morning is really a well-known passage. Some of you probably haven't memorized. And it's 1 Thessalonians 5:16 through 18. Here it is. "Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus." Friends, we can be assured that it's God's will for us to rejoice in the Lord. And what does that mean, to rejoice in the Lord? Is to thank Him for what He's done for you in the past. It's to thank Him for what He's doing right now in your life. And it's to thank Him for what He's going to do in the future. We have lots of reasons to rejoice in the Lord. It'll relift your spirits, by the way. And also pray continually. It's kind of like when you move around the city throughout your day. It's just about being in communion with Him. Maybe you're at work and you're up against something really difficult, and it's just praying quietly under, no one can hear you. Say, "Lord, give me insight into this situation. I want to do it with you. Thank you for this day, Father." It's just staying in touch with God continually. And also about it's God's will, friends, for us to give thanks in the midst of both good and difficult circumstances, because we know that God can use even the tough stuff that comes our way for our good. So friends, let's take a minute today now just to pray this verse into our lives. Would you do that? And I'll close in a moment. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. It always challenges us. always encourages us. So, Father, help us to listen to you when we read Scripture. And may we respond. Respond to you based on what you're seeking to teach us. And also I pray, Father, that our prayers would reflect the things that really, really matter to you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let me invite the worship leaders to come back and lead us in a closing song of worship. I'm going to ask you to stand as they come.